Welcome to Sunday Mornings at the Marxist Library. A quick note before we start, this session is being recorded and will be posted on YouTube with a link to our website, icssmarx.org, within the next few days. Welcome everybody to Sunday Mornings at the Marxist Library. In pre-pandemic times, this weekly program was hosted at the Nebel Proctor Marxist Library, located in Oakland, California, USA. During the pandemic, we have been meeting every Sunday on Zoom. In fact, we should say good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, because we now have attendees from throughout the United States and even from around the world. My name is Alan Miller. I'm a member of the program committee that organizes the Sunday Mornings at the Marxist Library sessions. I would like to start off by saying that we always welcome input, feedback, suggestions for topics, and suggestions for speakers. You can sign up for email notifications for our meetings and contact us through our website at icssmarx.org. For over a decade and a half, Sunday Mornings at the Marxist Library programs have been a platform for diverse presentations on a variety of topics, such as political economy, capitalism, socialism, communism, supporting the struggles of the working class, the fight against imperialism, militarism, racism, war, supporting the environmental movement. We would wish to remind you that this is a comradely forum for political discourse and debate. The opinions expressed here are those of the participants. They do not represent the ICSS or Marxist Library necessarily. However, we are united in our respect for the work of Karl Marx, and we believe that his work remains relevant today. Our motto is taken from Marx's 11th thesis on Feuerbach, quote, "The philosophers have only interpreted the world in various ways. The point, however, is to change it." Our session today is Stagnation, Recession. Our session today is titled Inflation, Stagnation, and Recession, Prospects for the U.S. and World Economy. Our speaker coming to us today from London, England, Michael Roberts, will analyze the latest developments in the major economies, such as inflation rates at 40-year highs and economic activity heading towards stagnation or worse. We will discuss what is causing this and what is needed to end this crisis. We would like to extend our warmest welcome to Michael Roberts, one of the world's leading Marxist political economists, who worked in the city of London as an economist for over 40 years, observing the machinations of global capitalism from within the dragon's den. At the same time, Michael has been a political activist in the labor movement for decades. Since retiring, Michael has written several books, including The Great Recession, A Marxist View in 2009, The Long Depression in 2016, Marx 200, A Review of Marx's Economics, 2018, and edited jointly with Guglielmo Carchedi, World in Crisis, 2018. He has published numerous papers in various academic journals and articles in leftist publications. We would like to express our gratitude for Michael's excellent work, in particular, his economics blog at thenextrecession.wordpress.com, thenextrecession.wordpress.com. It is highly recommended. After the presentation, we will have a short break for announcements followed by moderated question and answers where you can ask questions or comment on the subject of today's session. So with that, I'd like to welcome Michael and thank you very much for joining us today.
Well, thank you, Alan, and thank everybody at ICSS for inviting me to speak again on the subject of the world economy. I do appreciate the opportunity to present these ideas and hope that we can have a good discussion on what is going on in the world economy and in the US as well. In order to do that, I, as usual, Mike Roberts has a reputation of presenting a series of graphs to explain his arguments. So I'm going to share some slides with you. Hopefully we'll get that right.
We can see you might want to maximize your window.
So get that right.
That's better. Yeah.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So there we go. I'll just get a few things out of my way here. As you can imagine, so the subject is prospects for the world economy, as Alan said, inflation, stagnation, and recession. And as he also said, why is that not moving? Oh, there we go. This is what I want to cover. I want to cover, first of all, inflation and rates, as Alan said, are globally at the highest for 40 years, the inflation rate. So the question is, why have we got such high levels of inflation at the moment? Is it due to excess demand, people spending too much, forcing up prices, or having too much money in the economy, which means money chasing less goods, forcing up prices? Or is it due to disruptions in supply, the inability of production and trade and supply in general to meet demand? Is it wages going up too fast? Or is it profits that are rising too fast? What are the factors involved in the distribution of the income that's available both to workers and capitalists in the current economy? Now, central banks are mandated to reduce inflation rates. That's their target. That's what we have central banks for, primarily, so we are told. And their aim is to adjust interest rates and money supply and credit according to whether inflation is above a certain target or below a certain target. Currently, central banks are talking, and this week, Jay Powell, the head of the Federal Reserve, will be again meeting with the rest of the Monetary Committee, and the plan and the expectation is that he will carry out an increase in the Federal Reserve's policy rate by another 75 basis points, 0.75%, adding to the previous increases that we've had already this year. The aim is, by raising interest rates and also cutting back on the money supply, that this will bring inflation down. Will that work? And can inflation fall without a new global slump? I want to deal with that if I can. And are we heading into a period of stagflation? That is where an economy stagnates at around about zero growth, but still has inflation. Or are we going into an outright slump? That means that we have a period of at least half a year, if not longer, where there's actually a contraction in national output in various countries, including the US of A. And then the question is, of course, why is that happening? Why are we heading back into a global slump? So it's quite a lot of things, questions here. I'll see if I can try and answer them. First of all, let's start with the position on inflation. And as Alan said, near a 40-year high. On the left-hand side of this slide, the graph from the OECD economies, the latest figures, shows that headline inflation is up around 10%, and core is not so far behind. What do we mean by core inflation? That is, you take out food and energy price increases, which always seems to me somewhat unnecessary, considering that the most important things that many households have. But if you do, and just look at the rise in prices in other products, the argument here being that it gives you a feeling about whether it's just a small sectors of the economy which are high in inflation rates, and the overall inflation rate is not so bad. It's true, it's not quite so bad, but it's now reached 6%. You can see before the beginning of this year, the core inflation rate, the blue dotted line and the black arm one is the headline, are more or less the same. Now we've seen a big rise in the headline rate of inflation up to nearly 10% globally, that is, and core rate is at 6. If we look at the position of US inflation, that's about 9%. It's actually come down a little bit below 9%, but you can see that we also have a very high level of inflation in the United States, something we've not seen, as we say, for nearly 40 years. And as a result, because wages are not keeping up with the increase in inflation, then disposable income, that's what you've got after you've paid for an increase in prices and goods, and what you've got after you've got paid your taxes, that real income has made a sharp and crashing fall in this current year too. And this is a global figure for household incomes across the world on average is falling by 3% at the moment. So on average, household incomes have dropped by 3% compared to where they were last year at halfway through 2022 as a result of this inflation spiral. And it seems that energy costs and food costs, as we've seen, are the key components that have driven up inflation. Not only those, but in particular those. And we can see that energy costs are set to reach 13% of global GDP this year. So normally, energy costs constitute around 5 or 6% in the 21st century, even lower in the 20th century. But now we've got a figure which is a record figure. And that's all the costs of coal, oil, gas, hydro, solar, wind, nuclear, costs of energy, now constituting 30% of global GDP. And you can't see it very clearly from that, but of course the biggest increase is in the fossil fuel prices rather than solar energy and wind. The food price index has never been so high. It dropped a little bit, but it's never been so high. This is a world record high for the food price index across the world.
This is a global food price index provided by the Agricultural Organization of the UN.
And that is a shocking figure because it means that billions of people around the world, particularly in poor countries, are suffering a huge hit to their ability to buy food because of the rise in prices. So this is the situation we go through into the second half of 2022. What's the causes behind this? Well, one of the key causes, in my view, is that global supply bottlenecks are still on. What do I mean by still on? Well, during the COVID slump of 2020, we had lockdowns, we had production, we had workers laid off, we had furloughs, we had a dramatic reduction in production, and of course in trade and distribution of those goods and services, transport services in particular. But after the end of the global pandemic slump in 2020 and the so-called recovery last year, 2021, supply did not really improve. In fact, if you look at this measure by the New York Federal Reserve, which is a measure of the supply bottlenecks, you can see that generally speaking, supply bottlenecks didn't exist before COVID. There was a good movement of supply around the world and transport. In time, you could move everything very quickly. But now, during the COVID slump, the bottlenecks rocketed. It appeared to improve, but actually, as we went into 2022, bottlenecks in terms of port congestion, inability to move goods across the country, the lack of truck drivers, etc., and other logistics problems, lack of components for cars and so on, particularly electrical components, we've led to a complete blockage in lots of supply bases. And that's a key factor, it seems to me, in the inflationary spiral. And we just need to recognize that the hit of coming to living standards from the huge rise in inflation is particularly high for the poorest sections of households in all the countries. Here's a measure by the IMF, and it shows the hit, the blue dots, to the richest 20% of households from the rise in the cost of living. And you can see everywhere there's been a hit, anything between 0 and 5% of household spending has fallen in real terms as a result of the high energy prices. In many countries, the difference between the poorest 20% of households hit and that of the richest 20% is not very much. In France, it's not much difference. That's because France has capped its energy prices. But as you can see further down, you find that the poorest 20% of households tend to get bigger hit than the richest 20%. There's a gap here. Italy is quite sharp. The biggest gap we can find, and we don't have a US figure here, is between the UK, is in the UK. This is a hit to the richest 20% in the UK, which is bad enough, over 5%. But to the poorest, it's more like 13%. That's a huge gap. Only Estonia, tiny, tiny Estonia, can compete with that shocking figure. And we come to the question of inflation. I want to just take a slightly, it's not really a theoretical argument, but a logical argument that you've got to be aware of. What is inflation? It is not the level of prices, but the change in prices. And that's quite important, because let's just take a little example. Assume that we've got a price level, say, of 100. Now, then during the year after that 100, prices rise by 10%. So after the end of the year, prices are now at 110. If in the next year, the second year, prices rise by only 5%, inflation has slowed, but the price level has still risen to 115.5. So you might see in the papers, well, inflation's slowing. Yes, but the price level hasn't come down. In fact, it's still over 15% higher than it was 2 years ago. If we go into a third year, and inflation slows to 2%, which is what the central banks aim to achieve, now the price level is nearly 118. So it's risen by nearly 18% over 3 years. Inflation has slowed, but the price levels are up 80%. That's what the real damage is to people's household incomes, their incomes that they're earning when they go to work after 3 years. So the distinction between the level of prices and the change of prices, it seems to me, is very important and not to be forgotten. What are the causes of inflation? Well, the governor of the Bank of England doesn't agree that it's really supply congestion or problems with supply. He says that the problem is wage increases, or to be more fairer to him, he says that if people now ask for wage increases to compensate for inflation, they'll only make the situation worse by driving up prices. I'm not saying nobody gets a pay rise, he says, but what I am saying is that we do need to see restraint in pay bargaining, otherwise it will get out of control. More bluntly, Jason Furman, leading US economist, formerly with the White House economist, when wages go up, that leads to prices going up. If airline fuel or food ingredients go up in price, then airlines or restaurants raise their prices. Similarly, if wages for flight attendants or servers go up, then they also raise their prices. This follows from basic micro common sense. Well, I have to disagree with Mr. Thurman. It doesn't follow that if workers ask for wages increases to deal with rising prices, that necessarily leads to a spiral, a wage price spiral. In fact, the evidence does not show that to be the case. Just take a longer term view, we can see that over most of the major economies since the 1980s, actually wage shares in the total production of an economy have been in sharp decline. So whereas wage shares used to be, in the case of Japan, as much as 80% of total income, they are now down to 65%. If you want to take the United States, the green line was about 70%. And also down to 60%. So wage share in national income has been declining for over 40 years.
So the idea that suddenly wages are going to cause a price spiral when they haven't done so before seems to be pretty hard to justify given that data.
Now, Marx once was faced with this question back in the 19th century. One of his trade union comrades on the General Council of the International, the First Workers International, John Weston, who is a carpenter, presented the argument in a paper. He said that, look, wages, if we keep asking for wage rises to compensate for rises in prices, then all it will lead to is bosses raising prices, so inflation will only put wages back where they were in real terms. It's pointless asking for wage increases because it'll just be taken away by increased prices. So Marx replied to this in a little pamphlet called Value, Price and Profit, which was written after his address to Weston in the debate, which is on the right here. And he said, look, A struggle for a rise in wages follows only in the track of previous changes in prices. And I think that's clearly the evidence that we have at the moment. And many other things affect price changes, the amount of reduction, the productive powers of labor, the value of money, the fluctuation of market prices, and the different phases of industrial cycle. Is there a boom on or is there a slump on? All these are probably more important factors than anything that wages play the role. And in assuming all those things, then a general rise in the rate of wages will result not in an increase in the price of commodities, but usually in the fall in the general rate of profit or in profits. So if wage increases will squeeze profits, particularly if capitalists are not in a position to raise prices, given all these other factors that Marx mentions here. And that's the case at the present moment. Any increase in wages is likely to squeeze profits rather than drive up prices. And profits have been rocketing. Here are some very latest figures provided by American investment bank JP Morgan. They look at the change in global profits, global profits, not just US profits. This is a global figure. They show that between 2016 and 2018, there was nearly 47% rise in profits. Fell in 2019. That was quite important, I think, to demonstrate that probably a slump was on. And then the COVID slump saw a big fall in profits, 33%. But in the recovery year, there's been a staggering increase in global corporate profits, 80% plus on average throughout all the different sectors. And in the first half of this year, that has risen by another 7%. And if we look down the various components of the different sectors in capitalist economies, we can see that the biggest increases, staggering increases, are in energy profits, up 316% last year, and up 57% this year. And industrials and materials, which includes food and other things, have also risen sharply, particularly materials and industrials. Other sectors have not seen the same rise in profit, but in this year, but in 2021, also sharp rises. So we can see that what's driving prices is not wages, but a huge increase in profits, particularly in the energy, food, and industrial sector, where inflation has been strongest. And if we look at the energy companies, in the first 6 months of this year, the energy producers made a combined profit of nearly $100 billion. What I mean by the energy producers is not the people that you pay your bills to in a household. They could be a retail energy company or even the wholesalers that distribute the gas, electricity, and other forms of energy to households. But the actual producers of fossil fuel production energy in various forms and including renewables. These are the big international, multinational companies. So we can see companies like BP, Shell, ExxonMobil, Chevron,
France's Total. Together, just those companies alone in the first 6 months of this year have made nearly $100 billion in profit, not in profit. That's what they've been able to take back. And that's not being touched by anything. No wonder you get that level of profit, you're going to get that increase in prices.
So what are central banks proposing to do? Well, they tell us that that what they want to do is to moderate demand. They say this is the answer.
It's nothing to do with, particularly to do with supply or the huge profits that big energy companies are making, but simply too much demand by households. We're all spending too much, apparently, to drive up prices. So then we need to get wages down. Here's Jay Powell's comment here. The last meeting said the aim is to get a moderating demand to get wages down, and then we can get inflation down without having to slow the economy and have a recession and have unemployment rise material. That's what he aims to do.
So in other words, the problem is people now asking for wages to compensate for prices, as I've just seen the argument presented by Weston to Marx and by Jason Furman earlier. We must avoid that. So in fact, we've got to get wages down.
The solution to inflation is to get wages down, not to get profits down, but wages. In the UK, we have a similar argument from Keynesian liberal economist Martin Wolf. He said, what central bankers have to do is to prevent a wage price spiral, which would destabilize inflation expectations, so inflation would become out of control.
we must be tight monetary policy, but the central banks must be tight enough to achieve this in order to get some slack in the labor market. In other words, I get unemployment to rise or to get workers to accept wages. And that seems to be the aim of the central banks. When they talk about trying to control inflation, they're really talking about trying to get wages down. Can the Fed get inflation under control without unemployment rising and so achieve a soft landing? That's what the Fed claims it can do and will be claiming this Wednesday in its next meeting. It says by the end of 2024, 18 months or so away, or 15 months or so away, unemployment will only be up a little bit, 4.1% from 3.7%, but inflation will be suddenly down to 2.2%, a soft landing. I remind everybody, that's inflation rate. Of course, prices are still risen over those 3 years
and have not been reduced. They continue to rise. But some economists don't agree with that. They think it's totally impossible to imagine that the Fed can bring price increases down to 2% without inflation rising considerably more than a little bit of the Fed forecast. They may need to tolerate, in the US this is, an unemployment rate of 6.5% over the next 2 years.
That would translate into no less than 10.8 million unemployed workers, an 80% increase
from 6 million today.
That's the prospect in order to achieve the inflation control, which the Fed claims it wants to do. It could only do so
by dramatically raising the level of unemployment. And we've already
economic agencies. And they are saying that what we're heading for is a situation where inflation comes down, but it doesn't come down much from, say, the 8 to 10% we're seeing
globally. Maybe it comes down to 5 or 6%, but real GDP growth, in order to achieve that, dramatically falls as interest rates rise. And as I'll discuss very briefly after this,
other things happen to profits. So the IMF is saying the global outlook has darkened significantly. We're teetering on the edge of a global recession. Only 2 years
after the last one. That's a terrible thought. The terrible
year of the COVID slump is going to, in 2023, perhaps be replaced with another recession. And they expect world
GDP growth, not the US alone, to slow from 6% to 2.7% this year, and next year even lower. And this
slowdown from 21 to 22 now is the biggest
one-year drop in economic growth in 80 years. But nevertheless, despite that,
global inflation rates will still be much higher than
they were before the COVID pandemic. So we had, you could call it a form of stagflation.
Not quite stagnation, as far as the eye is concerned, but we'll see. But certainly inflation is still remaining at least 2 or 3 points above where it was before COVID. According to the
IMF,
already in the second quarter of this year,
if we look at the top or the G20 countries, that's the biggest 18 top economies, if it excludes Saudi Arabia, the energy producer, then most of these, all these countries
on average had a fall in GDP in the
second quarter of this year, which was ending in June. That's the blue square here. But inflation is still remaining, as we saw before, at around 6% core inflation in these economies.
So, in a way, we already have stagflation, according to the IMF. Goldman Sachs, only this last week, looked at what is the economic activity indicators, which they call PMIs, and they show that the world economy,
again, not just US and other countries, but the
world economy entered contraction territory this August,
for the first
time since the COVID slump. So we'll go into how they get this figure is worked out, but you can see that whereas back in the middle of 2021, there'd been quite a big recovery
from the COVID slump, which is this negative position here, to this height, and now it's heading down fast.
If it gets below 50, that's regarded as entering recession, and it's more or less there. And the World Bank, just this week, has made a really stark analysis of where the global economy is going. It's edging towards a global recession because central banks are simultaneously raising interest rates to combat persistent inflation.
the three largest economies have been slowing down already, and even a moderate hit to the global economy over the next year could tip the world into recession. And even if there is no slump, growth rates will be much lower than pre-pandemic forecasts. So if you see the right-hand graph in the World Bank, you can see, well, perhaps the bottom line is better, you can see that there is the baseline that they were hoping for starting this year as 100, going up to say 103, not very much. But if we get a sharp downturn, that will, the growth rate will be way less. And if we get the global recession, which they say is very possible now, and next year we'll actually see a fall from 100 to below 100 before there's a recovery. And what that means is, if you look at the top right-hand column, you can see this is the growth rate globally before the pandemic stopped. So if it continued as it was before, it had gone up this light blue line. But then we saw the slump in the pandemic and then the so-called recovery. But if this recovery peters out, it could slip down on this red line to here. But even if it doesn't, just look at the gap between what has been lost in world output, people's incomes, people's livelihoods as a result of the slump of the pandemic and the failure to recover to the previous trend growth rate. That gap is a loss of output forever, a loss of income forever. And that's what capitalism has achieved and does achieve in each slump. It generally failed in the last 10 or 15 years to get back to the previous trend.
In fact, this was one of the arguments I presented
in my book called The Long Depression. I argued that we're in a different period than previously, whereas previously recessions are like this. You went along here with trend growth, you had a slump,
and then you came back to the trend growth, so you only lost that little bit. But if you're in a depression, you come down here, you have a slump, but you don't go back to trend growth. So you're losing continually where you were before, lost forever the possibility of growth. And that's the situation we were
in before the pandemic broke in the 10 years of the 2010s. And it seems as we come out of the COVID slump and recovery, we're now going into a similar period where trend growth will not be restored. And each time that
trend growth is lower than it was before. So it's demonstrated that capitalism is finding it more and more difficult to recover from the slumps that it's getting into. And why is that the case? Well, I would argue
that Marx is right to present what he said was the law of the tendency of the rate of profit fall, in which he argued that over a period of time, a decade or more, whatever, there's generally a tendency for profitability under capitalism to fall. Now, you might find that strange when you read in newspapers the huge profits that capitalist corporations are making.
First thing to say about that is that they tend to be the very big companies, not the whole swathe of medium and small-sized companies across the
UFA or anywhere else. And if we look at the
average rate of profit against what capitalists have to spend on technology,
on factories, on construction, and on wages,
there appears to be, over a period of time,
a general tendency for that rate of profit to fall.
And that means that capitalism is facing continue the struggle
to maintain production investment, because investment and production doesn't take place unless there's going to be a profit for it. And if profitability is declining, then there's reluctance on the part of capitalists to make further investments. This is the most important law from the historical standpoint, Marx said. And it's a law that most people don't realize and has not been consciously articulated, but must do so, because the
rate of profit is the motive power of capitalist production. Things are only produced as long as they can be produced for a profit. And here are two measures of that rate of profit, both in the
world, if you like, the G20 countries, and in the US.
Okay, and you can see they're broadly the same, but in the period that we are in now,
we have seen generally a decline in the profitability of capital, despite those big increases we've seen for certain companies. And as we get up to 2020, then you can see that the growth rate, the rate of profit is down
pretty much near the lows we've seen since in the last 70 years, and way, way lower than the great period of capitalist growth
immediately after the Second World War, which many economists have called the Golden Age. The US rate of profit is pretty much similar. and we can see there's been no real recovery in the rate of profit. This period here is, okay, that's a different discussion, that the neoliberal recovery of sacking workers, ending trade unions, privatizing, globalization, and so on, managed to get the rate of profit up. But since then, it is the tendency has applied once again.
And it's worth pointing out that actually energy price rises, a very important part of the costs of production for capitalism, a key question, how to get energy cheaply in its raw materials and its use of production. If energy prices rise sharply, then it tends to hit profitability hard and can drive economies towards crisis. And we've seen every time there's been a big slump, as in the early 1970s, the 1980s and 1990s, then what has followed has been a severe crisis in production, investment and employment. And of course, that's exactly what we have at the moment. Energy profits may be high, but the hit to the rest of the capitalist sectors of high energy prices is beginning to squeeze their profits badly. And the workers are also asking for increasing wages. Their profitability margins and profitability in general is under serious threat as we go into 2023. And this is what I call the scissors of slump recently. What do I mean by that? I mean that there are two sides to what caused the slump. The first on the scissors here, if profitability and profits begin to fall, then that's one of the
blades in the scissors. And if the cost of interest rates and borrowing and servicing debt begins to rise, then that's the other scissor. And those two things begin going, one, the profits down and interest rates rises, the scissors begin to close and we will enter a slump.
And that's why you get a cycle of crisis from a boom, falling profitability, collapse in investment, financial crash, and then you get the slump. And that's the position which it seems that major economies are heading to in this year.
So the first part of that scissor is profits. Profits lead investment. There's a lot of argument amongst economists, mainstream economists, of course, by the way, you may not be surprised to know, don't even think there is profits in an economy. Is that possible? That's their theoretical position, when, of course, every day we read about profits. But these profits apparently don't really exist in driving in any way the economy at all. The economy depends apparently on marginal productivity or upon demand from households and so on. But the evidence shows quite clearly that when profits go up, investment goes up. When profits go down, investment comes down.
And the correlation, which is, I've got all the data here, but you don't need to read that, but I'll still send it to you later in the collection of these slides. The empirical correlations are very high to prove that point. But now, global corporate profits are slowing fast. And you can see here that we've come back from the recovery, huge rise in profitability we saw
earlier in the recovery after the pandemic. Now profits as a growth rate are coming down very fast, not far short of hitting zero next year, probably, maybe by the end of this year, just as they did before the pandemic started earlier and in previous small recessions. Once the profits
in general go into negative territory, then you get the slump. That's because capitalists then stop investing. And when they stop investing, economies come to a grinding halt. Economies are not driven
by whether households spend money, whether workers spend money or not primarily. They're driven by whether capitalists invest. And capitalists only invest if they're going to make a profit. If profits begin to disappear, they will stop investing. And here's six different recessions. 1 year before that recession, investment, which is the green block, falls by different amounts, but they all fall. There's a fall in the
level of investment, and as a result,
within a year, GDP falls. It's the red block, and production and their employment starts to fall. You notice the consumption of households doesn't make a lot of difference. In fact, it's not decisive 1 year before,
and in some cases, it doesn't really change too much during a slump. So the argument that Keynesians make, anyway, that it's what happens to the consumer,
whether households are spending or not, which decides what happens to an economy, is just not true.
What happens in an economy
depends on whether investment falls away, investment falls away because profit does. The other side of the scissor is the increase in the cost of debt, because all companies have debt, not only in the USA, but across the world. And if global business debt servicing rises because interest rates rise, then it's going to squeeze profits at the other end for capitalist companies. And business debt globally has never been so high as it is now. As we get went into the pandemic, it's really, really high. This is a measure against GDP, and so it's over 100% business debt globally. And that means that if interest rates, but during this period here, particularly here, when it was high, interest rates were very low, as you know. But now, during this end of the pandemic, we've seen a sharp rise in interest rates, and the Federal Reserve and other central banks are going to increase that even more. That means that a lot of companies who have just been struggling along without making much profit and are just servicing their debt and keeping their workers in employment, but not really being able to develop investment technology, we call these companies zombies, because they're not dead. They continue to operate, but they operate at such a level that they cannot actually expand in any way, and they can barely cover their debt servicing. These companies constitute something like 15% of the major economies around the world. That's quite a lot of companies. And they're in a severe trouble now if interest rates rise fast. So we can see that this is the other side of the scissors of slump. And let me get internationally, because we tend to concentrate on what's going on in the world by looking just at the advanced capitalist countries. But we should remember that the vast majority of people live outside those countries. They live in what we now call the global south, in Asia, in Latin America, in Africa, in Middle East and Central Asia. These areas, for the vast majority of people live, there are poorer, and they also have considerable burdens placed upon them in the ability to grow when all of their resources are extracted by the big imperialist companies out, and their profits disappear, and their wages are very low. So any sharp increase in global debt levels and the cost of financing that debt, particularly if it's in dollars, which often is going to be a serious hit to those countries. Global debt is really, really high, over 350% of global GDP at the moment, and something like $310 trillion at the moment. And with rising interest rates, that means a lot of these so-called emerging economies are in debt distress. You can see that as interest rates rise, a load of them will be hitting serious problems as we go into 2023. Because 30% of the debt that they held are variable, not fixed rates of interest, and they rise, and they're often had to be paid in dollars, and the dollar has never been stronger against all their currencies. So debt disaster is facing the global south. So it's not just a slump which will hit the major economies of the advanced areas in the global north, but also it will be a complete disaster in the global south. And already many countries there, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, Zambia, others are in serious default on their debts. So, as the World Bank says, the scissors of slump are closing. And this is the report this week. They say, unless supply disruptions and labor market pressures subside, those interest rate increases could lead the global core inflation rate, excluding energy and food, at about 5% next year, nearly double the five-year average before, and to cut global inflation to a rate consistent with the 2% target the central bank set, they would have to raise interest rates by another 2 percentage points, up to 4 or 5% from where they are at the moment. If this were accompanied by a financial market stress, which we've just been talking about, then global growth could slow to 0.5% global growth next year, or a 0.4% contraction if you take into account the increase in population. So that would be a global recession. So the World Bank is saying that more likely there will be a global recession next year, just after the one that we had in 2020, just 3 years later. I finish on this, Alan, and the rest of you. That's the situation at the moment in the world economy, as I see it. both in the global north and the global south. But I want you to remind you the bigger picture, which faces global capitalism over the next decade and beyond. The contradictions which are increasing in the 21st century, which we saw developing in the 20th, but are now reaching an intense level in the 21st century, leaving aside whether this slump takes place or not next year, we have contradictions that are not going to go away for capitalism. The first is the general economic contradiction. Financial crashes, deep recessions, a long depression, increasing inequality, and still not the eradication of poverty around the world, as many pro-capitalist economists claim. The data do not prove that. These contradictions in the economy, which Marx talked about 150 years ago, are reaching an intense position, as we see with the profitability of capital at such lows. So these contradictions are not going to go away. And this slump of 2023, if it comes, will only be followed, if the capitalism recovers, by another one at a later date, because under capitalism, when the drive for profit is the thing that decides whether things are produced that people need, and if profitability is in the cycle of boom and slump, then that means more slumps ahead. Then there's the environmental. This is so much more the issue of the 21st century than ever before. The climate change, global warming, nothing has resolved on this question. The Paris targets of 1.5 degrees centigrade increase since the Industrial Revolution in global temperatures will not be met. It's going to go well past that. There's no real effort on the part of the governments of the world and of the companies behind them, the fossil fuel companies as well, to control global warming and therefore climate change. The situation only get worse. And pandemics. We've had pandemics before. This was the worst one in 2020, but there is no guarantee with the degradation of nature and the exploitation of through industrial farming, mining, and so on, into the remote areas of the world, that we will not have more pathogens which spread across the world through international trade and transport in the future. The environmental situation is deteriorating drastically in 21st century capitalism. And then there is the geopolitical contradiction that with falling profitability, there is now increasing rivalry, particularly rivalry between the US as the hegemonic leading economic power of the 20th century, now facing regional rivals that threaten its hegemony, won't obey it and follow its policies and interests. And so we have not only the horrific war going on between Russia and Ukraine as a result of a proxy battle between the US and Russia over the control of Ukraine, but also the increasing likelihood of tensions and perhaps even war at some level between the US and China, which is part of the battle over trade and technology, which is increasingly will be the case if profitability continues to fall. So Marx said, capitalists are like brothers together. As long as there's plenty to go around, they share it out. But when there's less to go around, they become hostile brothers. And then they start arguing about who should control what. And arguing, of course, means military action as well as other measures to sanction rivals. To finish on this point, liberal economist Martin Wolf is deeply worried about the world situation. He says, the hope for peaceful relations is fading. No one knows what will happen. But we do know this looks to be a disaster. The combination of war, supply shocks, high inflation is destabilizing. The world learned in the 1970s. Financial instability now seems very likely. A prolonged bout of stagflation seems certain, with large potential effects on financial markets. In the long term, too, the emergence of two blocks with deep splits between them is likely as an accelerating reversal of globalization and the sacrifice of business interests to geopolitics. Even nuclear war is, alas, conceivable. An IMF chief, Guglielmo Carchedi, said that
we live now in a more shock-prone world.
Yes, the shocks have been coming thick and fast in the 21st century.
Georgieva said, and we need the strength of the collective will to deal with these shocks. Well, I answered that question by saying, do we expect the collective will of the capitalist powers, the governments and so on, to deal with these shocks?
They failed over climate change. They failed to prevent and stop the COVID pandemic. They failed to prevent poverty still being existing around the world and getting worse as a result of the pandemic. And they haven't kept world peace governments. In fact, the situation of tensions and conflict increase. Instead of relying on them, as far as I'm concerned, as socialists, we must depend on the collective will of organized working people to turn this around.
And then the deteriorating position around the world now.
Thank you, Michael, for an incredibly informative presentation. What we're going to do is take a short break right now for announcements and fundraising. We would ask everybody, if you have any questions, any comments, to please go to your reactions button and raise your hand. We'll take your questions and comments after the break, and we hopefully will have some lively discussion here. So with that, what I'd like to do is let me ask Jean to talk about upcoming sessions and announcements. And I'm going to let you unmute yourself, Jean, if you would do so.
Okay. Well, thank you, Michael, so much. This is very provocative, and I see people are already lined up with questions. So I'll be brief. We have some excellent programs coming up as usual. Next week, September 25th, I believe, or 23rd, is Socialism Betrayed? Roger Keane and Keeney will discuss their book and its relevance after the decease, passing of Gorbachev. Following that, October 2nd, Imperialism Revisited, our friend and comrade Greg Godelz will speak on that issue, and that's a very provocative issue as well. And finally, October 9th, We the Elites, Why the U.S. Constitution Serves the Few, something we all know in our bones, but we'll have Robert Orvets here to talk to us on that. So I'm looking forward to those classes and also to our discussion today. So back to you, Alan.
Thank you, Gene. And Richard, if you would just make a brief announcement.
Yeah, thank you. For those of you who want to contribute to the work financially of ICSS, I put an announcement in the chat for those of you who want watching live on how you can do that. For those of you who are watching on YouTube, please go to our website, icssmarx.org, and click the donate button. That site also has information on how you can watch previous presentations on ICSS, our archive. So, please be generous. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Okay, so we're going to go over to question and answer. Boy, the hands went up so quickly that I didn't see the order in which they went up, so I'm just going to take them in the order. It's basically alphabetical order.
I'd just like to apologize. Some people have complained about the audio. I apologize. I can't understand why it's so bad, but it seems to be. I hope we can solve that in the question and answer. And I have posted the slides on the chat for people to help.
Excellent. Thank you, Michael. Okay, so why don't we start off, and let's start with Mike. If you would unmute yourself and ask your question, followed by Nina and Janet. So Mike G, please.
Yeah, thank you very much. And thank you for a really, really interesting and informative presentation. I'm not much of an economist myself. Not my Marxism is more sort of tilted towards social justice, but these issues all intersect significantly. I just wonder from your expert perspective, what you think the impact of the sort of movement of jobs, the export of jobs from the West, particularly towards China following 2001, may have contributed to the current situation that we're in the sense that I believe it may have resulted in keeping interest rates and inflation artificially low. And because of the impact of that significant change on ordinary working people's lives and the availability of well-paid jobs, government debt began to increase and government deficits began to increase, adding a significant burden again to the lives of ordinary working people. And whether or not, if you think that I've got this, that there's some merit in what I'm saying, whether the answer might be something a bit more optimistic, like shrinking the size of the state whilst actually maintaining solid socialist principles about supporting the needs of those who have the requirement for support and are not able to sort of, if you like, adequately fend for themselves within the economy. That probably sounds quite complicated. I hope it doesn't sound as though it's not answerable.
Go ahead, Michael.
I'll go do them one by one. Okay, well, thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
It's a quite complicated question you've posed, but let's say what we talk about the period from particularly 1990, but also from 2000, the so-called period of globalization, where what happened was a lot of the multinational companies in the global north moved their factories and other services abroad, particularly to the what used to be called the third world and the global south, in order to take advantage of much lower wage levels and also to use on the basis of new technology. They can combine the two things together, the best technology with the cheapest workforce. Yeah, and we saw this huge expansion of globalization into these countries, particularly China, as you say, with a massive labor force available. And we saw a tremendous expansion of production in those countries and exports from China back into the global north. This meant, of course, a severe loss of jobs in what used to be called the smokestack industries in the US and Europe. This began really even as early as the 1980s. And it was part of what some economists call the neoliberal recovery, where because profitability of capital had reached lows, and if you saw my slide, was so low, the profits crisis in the 1970s. 1980, we saw two slumps and then recovery in profitability, and then this long neoliberal period to drive profitability up, both by domestic process of privatization, trade union rights, and other reductions in the state sector, as you pointed out, and of course, globalization. Now, that meant a loss of jobs, and it also meant the decline in wage share in the national income, which I pointed out in one of the graphs as a result. Now, the question is, I pose to you, that what happened was, despite the efforts of capitalists to restore profitability, they could not sustain that situation in the 21st century. We've seen profitability begin to fall, leading eventually to the Great Recession of 2008-9, and subsequently into a long period of what I call depression, low growth, low investment, low productivity in particular, which means that people have got jobs, but they're not very productive, they're in poor jobs, they're not combined with good technology in productive areas. A lot of profitability has gone into the financial sector and the property sector, what you might call unproductive areas. So if we're trying to improve the economies of places like the USA and elsewhere, the question is to get productivity up. And that means to get investment in productive areas up. And it means reducing investment in unproductive areas. Some of those unproductive areas are in the state sector, the public sector. I can think, and I think you can quickly gather what the most unproductive sector in the state sector might be in all these countries. It is the military. The military sector is a huge unproductive sector where huge amounts of resources and money and profits and workers are employed to produce weapons to go around just killing human beings in various forms or providing support and control for US imperialism and its junior coalition partners, as we're seeing presently at the moment. And as you know, the federal spending on military has dramatically increased even in the last year while this slump is going on. So if we want to get a smaller state that doesn't waste resources,
then that's the first area I would start with. And the second area is to end the subsidies, the massive subsidies to multinational companies, particularly fossil fuel companies, which are using up large sections of public spending. And remember, during the COVID slump, the vast majority of money that was raised through borrowing to be handed out went to businesses, particularly big businesses, not to working people to survive during the crisis. So these are areas that we need to cut back. So when people say to me, what we need is a smaller state so that capitalism can work better, my reply is, well, will you start with the military? Will you start with arms expenditure?
Thank you very much. Very interesting.
Okay, thank you. What I'd like to do is just remind everybody to try and limit your questions to about 2 minutes, because we have a lot of people with their hands up. And also, that
I'll try to speak a little less too.
That we don't put any restriction on the responses, but I wanted to let people know that I'm going to be going in different order on the list. And as soon as the list goes down a little bit, I'll get back to taking people in the order in which hands were raised. So next up is Nina, followed by Janet. So Nina, if you would unmute yourself and ask your question, appreciate it. Thank you.
Oh, okay. Let's see. So it seems like with American workers, from what I can tell and what I've been reading, is that the way to cope, where a lot of people are coping with inflation and buying what they need to sustain themselves, but also with their student loans, is that people are going into debt. So they're not really earning total amount of money that they need in order to sustain themselves. And perhaps with your expertise and skill, could tell me what the outcome of this is going to be if everybody has a credit card debt and then they have a educational debt. I think it may be in Britain, they have funded education much more. In European countries, they don't have such expensive college education. I think that isn't that true? I guess that's the question. But also, in terms of everyone here is in debt, just the working class and then for educational loans, and then you have a big credit card debt for your groceries, et cetera, and gas. If it just keeps on going like that and they don't pay it off, what is the ultimate end of all of that?
Well, it means a lot of people are forced into severe poverty, doesn't it? And what we're particularly seeing in the 21st century is an increasing level of debt held not only by households. We saw that during the great global financial crash, that people took out a lot of mortgages, which they were given to by the banks. And then, of course, they eventually had to default on those mortgages when the slump began and we had the financial crash which followed. So it is a perpetual cycle of people struggling to get a better life and better living conditions, and then faced either with a new slump or with such levels of debt that they're unable to pay it, and they're forced to. They lose their homes, they lose their property, such as it is, and they lose their, and often they lose their jobs because they cannot sustain those jobs and the incomes that are involved. And whole layers of people are in that position on a cyclical basis. This is the nature, even in the 21st century, of capitalism, even in the richest countries. I was just reading today, for example, that now the average mortgage payment for a US household is going to be $2,000 a month, with interest rates rising as they are at the moment, further to go. In the UK, it's truly horrific, the cost of living, particularly energy. They're talking about an increase in energy bills for the average household in the UK going from about £1,000 a year to £6,000 a year, or the average bill. If you think about £6,000 difference of £5,000, that's something like $8,000 a year coming out in 1 year out of the average household income that didn't have to pay before. That's a truly staggering hit And that's why governments in the UK are panicking. Student debt is particularly high, we know, in the US, because you do have very high education costs, I mean, fees and just trying to survive at college to get a degree, to get a better job, and so on, is an issue that hits the whole layers of young people in the US. But I have to tell you, unfortunately, whereas when I went to college, and I won't tell you how long ago that was, but it was almost in medieval times, we didn't pay any fees to go to college, and we even got a grant, not a loan, we got a grant from the government to go to college for the 3 years or 4 years or whatever it was. Gradually, that's all been whittled away. And now in the 21st century in the UK, college fees are now very high, and everybody has to get a loan, and they're left with huge debt, just as they are for American students as well. And that's also beginning to happen in Europe. What has happened is a complete reduction and dismemberment, I think, to use a phrase from somebody in the chat. And all these gains that working class organizations made after the Second World War in establishing better society, a better social wage of public services, education, health services, so on. Health is, you don't have a public health service in the US. We do in Europe, but I have to say it's being decimated day by day, week by week, through increases in fees, reductions in staff and everything, the hollowing out, everything now is being contracted out to private companies, mainly US health companies, you know what they're like. Everything is turning back from what was gained over 50 years ago
by working people after the Second World War.
Okay, thank you. Next will be Janet, if you would please unmute, followed by Youssef. Janet, go ahead. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for your presentation and also for sharing your slides. I apologize in advance. My thoughts are not terribly organized, but in any case, I wanted to mainly ask you to talk about how you see housing and property ownership, how they factor into all of this, especially in the United States, where property rights are built into its constitution. I believe that in the US, a third of households are renters and two-thirds are homeowners. The number of renters in California are higher. So what's been happening is homeowners are becoming renters. That is on the rise. Homelessness continues to increase. In Oakland, investing is in luxury housing, I think elsewhere as well. And existing rental housing, it's not being really even existing, right? Profits increase because of rent increases that are based on formulas or whatever. It's like inflation, you know, so every year it's a percent on top of a percent, whatever. Due to the pandemic, probably in Oakland where I live, the annual rent increase was supposed to be 6.7% in Oakland, and this year, and it's been kind of no higher than, let's say, 3% in previous years. Fortunately, that formula was changed. It tops now at 3%. Basically, the issue about housing, the cost of housing, and how that affects this whole thing.
Well, Janet, I have to say that it's housing question. It's often neglected, isn't it, when we talk about these things. It's, talk about education, we talk about health, we talk about those wages, but we don't often clearly look at the question of housing. And it reminds me, Frederick Engels in the 1880s wrote a small pamphlet called The Housing Question. And in that book, in that little pamphlet, which is worth reading, he points out just about everything you've just said. He said, nothing's changed, I'm afraid, that we have a situation where some people have the illusion that if they're owner-occupiers, that they're going to be fine and dandy. But of course, we know that's not the case when mortgages rise and they find themselves burdened with heavy debt. And the people who can survive as owner-occupiers tend to be older people like myself who got away with it in the past and now have plenty of what we call equity in their property. And so they're not really hit too hard if they have no mortgages at all. But whole layers of younger people, people who are coming into looking for a better life, who need decent housing to live in to bring up their families, are faced with either exorbitant mortgages that they have to take out, and with prices rising dramatically at all times, because what has happened is a lot of the resources of the world under capitalism have moved into property speculation, and that's why these prices are driven up rather than productive areas. And when people cannot get on the housing ladder, and they have, in snakes and ladders, they're already slipping down the snake, these people have to go renting. And exactly the same situation is happening in Europe as it's happening in the US. Rents are rising dramatically. It seems that you have some sort of controls at California. Well, I can tell you there's no controls in the UK. Landlords can charge what they want, and they do so. And at the moment, they're hiking rents considerably, so that very young people are having to either stay at home with their parents, or they're having to gang together with others to try and get some sort of squalid accommodation in order to develop. And the idea of getting a family and developing that is increasingly difficult. And there is no, what is the answer to this? There is no social or public housing of sufficient supply to meet the needs of the population. When we talk about meeting the social needs of people, housing is one of the basic things that we have. We need homes for people. And yet everywhere, capitalism does not provide public housing for everybody. And the result is you either faced with the choice of trying to take out an expensive mortgage and get yourself hugely into debt, which you'll pay off for the rest of your working life, or you're renting and giving landlords huge amounts of money with nothing to be gained. Why do we not have a massive program of public housing and projects, these projects around the world, those in the USA and in Europe? We did for a brief period in the early 1930s and in the 50s and 60s in Europe, but since then, just as all the other things, that hasn't been the case. It's just another condemnation of the market economy and the capitalism, that it fails to meet the needs of people. And housing must be one of the most important ones.
Okay, next is Yusuf, followed by Richard W. and Roger Harris. So go ahead, Yusuf.
Thank you. First of all, thank you very, very much for a very professional, very informative talk. In spite of the audio problems, it was wonderful. And also maybe my deficiency in catching British English. But I would like you to please elaborate a little more on the sort of dialectic relationship between the international crisis, the geopolitical situation, as you mentioned. My non-professional observation is that the recent inflation seems to be very much tied to the crisis, the international crisis, particularly this proxy war, as you put it, in Ukraine, and also a mutual sanctions or blockades. So could you please elaborate on those topics?
Well, Yusuf, I think you're right. Obviously, the extreme increases we have seen in prices, particularly in energy and food, are
the extreme ones in the last few months have been due to the Russian invasion of Ukraine and the conflict there, the response of the Western powers, the NATO powers, to introduce a whole range of sanctions against Russia and Putin's friends, but also to try and block all sorts of exports and imports to Russia, not energy, because Europe still needed Russian gas in particular, but also Russian oil. But that has increased prices across the board, plus the fact that the Russians have cut back gradually in retaliation on gas supplies to Europe. So gas prices until the last month rocketed to extreme levels in Europe. So this is a big factor in the recent inflation. But even before the Russian invasion in February of this year, energy and food prices are on the rise. And the argument I'm presenting to you was that this wasn't because workers were spending too much money and driving up prices, because wages hadn't really recovered at all, but it was due to two factors: the extreme inability of the capitalist economy to get going with increasing production again. Productivity remained low, supply did not respond to the recovery as workers went back to work. The capitalist system was sluggish and inability to increase supply. We had a lot of blockages, as I described, and that was another factor. And also, what was happening was big capitalist companies were taking advantage of the situation to raise prices and boost their profits, particularly in the energy and food areas. And as a result, we saw big increases in profits. So I say an average increase of 80% in the profits, in global profits of corporations last year, 2021, and 350% in the case of energy. So already before the Russian invasion, we began to see that inflation was being driven by these factors. And the point I would make here is that tells you that when the Federal Reserve and other central banks try to aim at increasing interest rates, which they claim will get inflation down, it will have little or no effect, because it's not due to wage increases being too high or all these factors. If borrowing costs rise, that will be less spending. But the problem is that supply is not coming through. The congestion in supply remains. And now the squeeze in particular areas like energy and food prices as a result of the conflict in Ukraine is continuing that process. And all the evidence is showing, as I presented to you from the international agencies, that they expect next year inflation, even if it comes down from the 8 to 10%, it will still be 5 or 6% next year. And at the same time, we'll have no growth at all in production. So that is the crisis that we face over the next year and into 2024 as well.
Okay, next is Richard W., followed by Roger, followed by Sharon. So Richard, if you would unmute.
I wanted to thank Michael for a good presentation.
I hope you managed to hear it. It clears that some people failed.
well, not that, but just to give you a little bit of background, I'm basically a Marxist econometrician. So I was happy. you touched on, well, I had a couple of questions. In some respects, I sort of feel sorry for Powell, because he's been tasked with trying to save an economy for which we have not been, we for like the last 30 or 40 years, we have not been spending anywhere what we need to be spending on social welfare. Instead, as you pointed out, we sent those resources toward basically military production, and as a way of defending the corporations. Meanwhile, the capitalists have been disinvesting in this country at the expense of the workers in this country, bringing down their standard of living down to those of the Asians, and forcing those people to live on credit cards. I had a lot of questions here. Could you address how we can get out of the military part of our economy? We're really, as you pointed out, we're wasting a lot of resources on a very unproductive sector of the economy. And in the meantime, we're encouraged. We've got this whole. Anyways, I'll leave it at that. If you could just address the military industrial side of things, thank you.
Yes, Richard. I suppose everybody will remember the phrase military industrial complex was first coined by President Eisenhower, and he ought to know because he had been the commander in chief in the Second World War of Allied forces in Europe. And he pointed out that the close connection that exists between the big multinational arms companies, but not just the arms companies, but the fossil fuel companies, the energy companies, everybody connected very closely to the process of the military. And that connection, that complex, has not changed, has it, in the last 70 odd years? Yeah, and it existed obviously before the Second World War to some extent, but has been increasingly integrated, so that companies like Boeing, Lockheed, and so on, and all the rest, they depend entirely and increasingly not on civil sales, although that's one thing, but on the ability of the federal government and NATO and other countries to provide them with sales of various weaponry, planes, etc., and all the rest of it. And this is a huge section of the economies of countries. Now, when we look at government expenditure of the military, it's only about 2-3% of GDP, or so it seems. But when you add in things like security, home security, all the other measures of intelligence and other parts of the military operation, and of course the connections that exist internationally for these sales, it's way, way more than that. It's a big, big part and an essential part of the capitalist process. So my answer to you, Rich, is that there's no way that this military sector can be broken away from the rest of capitalism. It's now totally integrated together. So the only solution to ending this ludicrous, unproductive, and destructive spending on arms around the world is the removal of capitalism, because they're totally connected together. And without, say, taking over the fossil fuel companies, the big international arms companies, bringing them in and changing what they produce and the workers involved in them, using the skills of the workers involved in them for things that we need socially, can we end this nightmare, which will continue through the rest of this next few decades unless something changes? And as you point out, we're in the position where the geopolitical conflict is going to is increasing, and the role of this military-industrial complex is going to play an even more destructive and negative factor over the next 10 or 15 years.
Okay, next is Roger, followed by Sharon, followed by Raj Sahai. So Sharon, if you would unmute and ask your question.
Thank you for that presentation. It was very informative.
Roger.
I understand who you meant. Yeah. The presentation was very informative. I very much enjoyed it. I thought the graphic materials very much helped me, particularly because it was hard for me to follow the audio.
And
I don't know what that issue is, but we'll have to address that. And I've also really enjoyed reading your blog over the years. So it's really, really appreciate you coming and making this presentation. I have two questions. One segues from Richard Wright's question, and that relates to the comment, which I believe he made, that some of the tools that we would have to combat stagflation is reducing investment in military and subsidies to the fossil fuel companies. And if you could elaborate a little on that, I'd appreciate that, because often we hear from particularly bourgeois economists just the opposite, that military Keynesianism is the solution to the problem rather than the cause of the problem. The other thing, if you could comment on, I'd appreciate it, is you spoke about the differential effects of changes in the world economy to the global north and the global south, very dramatic different effects. But could you also address, if you could, the differential effects within the capitalist camp, and particularly between the US and the UE, European Union. You quoted an economist by the name of Wolf, and you said, he mentioned something about the sacrifice of business interests for geopolitical interests. And it seems absolutely amazing on your side of the pond, how so many countries have capitulated to buying US energy and buying US armaments against their economic interests, or at least what I would perceive as their economic interests. So if you could address that as well, is there a shift in the balance of power within the rival imperialist countries toward the United States in this recent period?
Very good questions, Roger. It's particularly the second one, but let me just take the first one about whether military spending is actually beneficial to capitalism, and we've far from reducing it. We should be increasing it because it will help to provide jobs, presumably, is the argument, and spending by the workers in those industries and spread across the economy. And because it's so important, if we were to cut it back, it would damage the economy of the US and other countries with these high levels of military spending. Well, I've never really believed that argument is the case. First, let's say from the point of view of working class people, that clearly is not the case. We don't need more arms around the world to kill people with. Working people, if they came together, would soon get rid of this aspect of the economy in a period of harmonious world government, and would guarantee world peace on the basis of that. But of course, working people are not in charge of their economies. These governments representing big business and a small elite are in charge, and they are much more interested in trying to increase their profits and their share of the world exploitation of working people. And that means that they have to use arms to do so, then they're prepared to spend. It also becomes almost a product of itself. It can't be stopped. You spend more money on arms because you spend more money on arms. It becomes a process which cannot be stopped. But in terms of whether it benefits capitalism, well, I think there's been quite a good few studies on it, and it shows that it's not really beneficial to capitalism at all. Yes, it might be beneficial to some extent to the arms-producing economies, but for the arms-importing economies of capitalism, and they're the majority, they lose out with these huge expenditures that they have to make in order to provide backing for their particular national interests. And there used to be an argument amongst some Keynesian economists and even Marxists back in the period of the 60s that capitalism had saved itself through what was called the permanent arms economy, that the expansion of the arms sector would provide sufficient demand to maintain full employment in capitalist economies. Well, that argument has been proved wrong, and was proved wrong in the 70s and 80s and onwards. It didn't stop booms and slumps and serious losses of employment, despite the size of the military sector. But your other second question is really important, because I agree with you. It's staggering how quickly the elites of the European Union have swung behind US imperialism in this last period of this year, from presumably being a rival economically to the US, to one that appears to be almost a capitulation to US imperialism. And the result has been, of course, that the elite
of the European Union and their leaders and so on, particularly in Eastern Europe, are so antagonistic towards Putin's Russia, and the idea that Putin's Russia threatens the interests of the European Union, and in particular could hold them to ransom over gas and energy imports, that they have dramatically changed their view and are prepared to become under the wing of US imperialism and US energy supplies over the next few years. Whether they can achieve sufficient energy production out of relying upon the US and maybe some other sources as opposed to what they've lost and will lose from Russian imports remains to be seen. But all I would say is that basically the European Union is going to suffer badly economically over the next 3 or 4 years, maybe longer, as a result of this switch. And they're going to have to increasingly face the view that American imperialism is establishing itself control over a bloc that we haven't seen since the end of the Second World War, which had been broken up in the last 70 years and has been established. But on the other side of this, in the West, we have a new bloc, if you like, developing in the East between Russia, China, and other countries, India perhaps as well, and other countries who are not part of the imperialist bloc led by the US. This is a very dangerous situation, which we'll see over the next decade or so. And the hot point, the hot spot point is going to be Taiwan and what happens there between China and the US.
Okay, next up is Raj Sahai. I'm sorry, Sharon, followed by Raj, followed by Jean. So Sharon, if you would unmute. And,
thank you. Thank you, Professor Roberts. That was a really important talk, and I learned a lot. And I certainly feel that your conclusion that capital will never solve this problem, only organized working class will be able to solve it. But I wanted to ask, from the point of view of the working class, what kinds of immediate and longer term demands should we be raising and fighting for? I can think of three. A freeze on prices and rents, an increased level of and duration of unemployment benefits, and guaranteed income. What do you think of those, and what would you add to that?
Well, Sharon, I think I agree with yes, we need to, what are the immediate demands? The immediate demands in a cost of living crisis, which we're now entering, is that yes, some people proposed freezing prices, freezing rents, freezing the things which are hitting working people's income, their disposable income. Unfortunately, freezing hasn't allowed them to get prices up in the last year and a half so much. Do we cut those things back to where we were before? Can we restore the loss of income which people have suffered in the last year? So I always say to people who say, well, price freezes, because it's quite popular amongst the left at the moment, price controls. You can't say that there's something wrong with that, but if it's only price controls and without changing the structure of the economy, leaving the energy companies where they are, doing what they are doing, not changing the position by which this situation has arisen in the first place, then price controls can only be, as it were, a small band-aid on the wound, which is affecting our cost of living, and that we need to transform the structure of the economy. What are the demands of those? Well, you add in another one, you say, well, we need a guaranteed income, a basic guaranteed income. Again, that's something, obviously, I mean, the minimum wage in the US has not moved for decades. And the real value of the minimum wage has dramatically fallen. So you could say, well, we need a sharp increase in the minimum wage that everybody should get when they go to work. And that's a basic need. But again, if we don't change the structure of the economy, then all this stuff is, if you like to say, papers over, bandages up some of the wounds, but doesn't really do away
with what's causing this crisis. Now, my view is that we have to move beyond that, and we have to say that we have to end the process by which the energy companies, the food companies, the health insurance companies, and so on, the pharmaceutical companies dominate and cost of living. We need public ownership of those companies. We need control of those companies through a democratic plan, a plan we could start by providing basic public services free at the point of use. I've heard to cry we need a universal basic income. I think we need a universal basic services. What things could be free at the point of use now? Well, health is one that we have to some extent in Europe. You don't have that. Education is another one, but also transport. There is absolutely no reason why the cities, the big cities of the United States and Europe, and there are a few in Europe, provide free transport.
That would dramatically improve the ability of people to get to work, to do other things, and reduce the basic congestion of diesel-powered engines, the cars are roaming the countryside and destroying the environment and driving up prices. Free transport. In my view, we must move on beyond that to free public housing point of use, or at least housing at a level of rents that people can afford to pay. That means public services, basic services. This is not utopia. This is not wild dreams. It's been costed by many good leftist economists recently, and how that could be done. If resources are moved in that direction and away from the unproductive resources which governments spend now, if rich companies and rich people were taxed properly to provide us the resources to do that, and if we had control of the strategic sectors of the economy, the banks, I hear lots of, we always talk about having public ownership of something. Nobody ever mentions the public ownership of the banks. There are all public banks in the US, and the public service banks. Banking should be a public service which provides people with money, that the credit that they can't do from their own wages, for resources and for small businesses to invest, not for speculation in the stock market, the bond market, and derivatives bringing everything crashing down, for huge bonuses to be made by banking executives and other CEOs. We need a complete change in the whole structure of the economy to achieve that. They can be linked to the basic things that you pointed out, like wages, incomes, and controlling rents and prices. But if we stop there, we'll only go back in perpetually into the cycle again later on. We need to move on to take a change in the structure of the economy as a whole.
Okay, next is Raj, followed by Jean, followed by Kit. Raj, if you would unmute and ask your question.
Dr. Roberts, thank you for your talk. I have a few observations and then focus on my question. They're related to my question. Just from your talk, it's clear the global profit rate with all the capitalist production combined is fallen below where Marx says it's sustainable. In other words, it has fallen below that minimum 10% below which crises are there, even though the energy sector is reaping huge profits, though all global is. So that's one thing I got from your talk. Second is that there's, of course, we all know the climate crisis is adding to the economic crisis because there are losses in productivity, losses in production in general, and disruptions caused by it. So that's the second thing, and you mentioned that. And the third thing, you said there is a rival bloc has arisen among capitalists. So there are two blocs now, clearly. And there is, some people are talking about multipolarity, but you as a Marxist will agree with Lenin that actually, bipolarity is really what happens. You cannot have a unipolar world much longer. So that's happening. I think that's headed, rival bloc is headed by China with Russia in it. So, and then the fourth is, which is my thought, that after the First and Second World War, the stage of monopoly capital had actually receded. This is something I would like to ask your opinion if you agree. And capitalism could be productive again, productive in the sense of making profit. It was not in the stage of moribund condition of monopoly capital. But we have returned back to that by 1975, once again, because all these production centers, China included, India included, Europe, of course. So once again, we have reached even a very in monopoly stage. So that brings me to the question. Of course, China and Vietnam and three other smaller countries are run by communist parties. But I believe China and Vietnam today are capitalist economies. They're run by communist parties, so they're a different kind of animal, but they are capitalist economies. And the crisis seems to me, and I think I also conclude from you, cannot be solved within capitalism. Yet I see working class has not shown very much of a tendency to move towards communist parties, especially those who are trying to overthrow the system. They are not attracted to that. And that's whether it is United States, India, or any other major countries, forget about minor, because, you know, even if they're, they don't. So where do you think a radical hope of transformation comes from? So that's my question to you. It's a high level question to you, but it's based on your talk. Thank you very much.
Well, Raj, yes, you asked the most difficult questions, as we all know. I'll take the last one last, because it is the most difficult. Just to say that, after the Second World War, destruction of facilities, particularly in Europe and elsewhere, and a massive laying off of workers from labor and so on, had dramatically increased the profitability of capital. So capitalism after the Second World War, at least in the advanced capitalist world, had what was called a golden age, high profitability, which lasted for a couple of decades before it started to decline again. And this laid the position, recovery of labor, huge amounts of labor force to be used cheaply with new technology that had been developed before the Second World War in various ways. And the big spending in Europe to restore and recover Europe so it didn't fall into the hands of communism. So we got a big expansion of capitalism. That's a great period. It was an exceptional period. The period from when I was born to the point that I went to university was a period of exceptional golden age for capitalism. Exceptional in the sense it has not been repeated and was probably not even repeated before, except perhaps in the early part of the 20th century, the late part of the 19th century. This golden age of two decades, it disappeared. So that the original decline in profitability led to the increased rivalry between capitalist powers, but also in this case, in a move towards a new revival of imperialism. So we saw the expansion of capital into areas of the world which hadn't had that much expansion before, into Asia in particular, into China and elsewhere, and the big profitabilities that these companies hope to make expanding that. We've seen a huge extraction of profit from the so-called global south to the global north. It's an important factor in maintaining the profitability of capital in the US and other countries. Otherwise, it would be even lower than it is now. Imperialism has been an important factor. So in the sense when you talk monopoly capital has come back, use that phrase, it's more imperialism as still there. So recently, in 1915, Lenin wrote a book called Imperialism, the Latest Stage of Capitalism, which he pointed out the domination of a few powers in the north of the world and controlling the rest of the world. 100 years later, that hasn't changed at all. We have exactly the same imperialist group in Europe and the US and Japan, and everybody else are also ranked, including China, even though it's become a big power economically, in terms of its ability to compete on a world scale, in militarily, financially, against the imperialist powers, it's still not there at all, despite its size. And India is still nowhere. These countries have made progress, but the gap between the imperialist powers and the others remains great in 100 years after we wrote that book. And imperialism, the problem, as you pointed out, is imperialism is finding it increasingly difficult, particularly in the US, in order to maintain its position as a hegemonic power,
And so we tend to have a creasing conflict between those powers that don't recognize the diktats of US imperialism, which apparently no longer includes the European Union, we're now willing to go along with it, Russia and China and other countries. Whether that develops into two serious blocks remains to be seen. But what do we do about this is a wonderful question, which why is the working class doing nothing about it? How many Zooms and meetings have you been to where that question is not asked? And of course, I'm now supposed to provide an answer to you, Raj, unlike the rest of us who haven't been able to answer this question very clearly for some time. All I would say is this, I've attempted to look at it from an economic-based point of view, if you like, the objective conditions. And when have been the periods of most revolutionary or intense class conflict? They have been periods when the working class is relatively strong, it's well organized, and the capitalists have allowed that to develop, and then they have tried to reverse the process. That happened in the 1970s, when profitability fell in the capitalist world. The workers are very strong, and so we had intense struggles, high levels of strikes, revolutions in Europe. The Greek dictatorship was overthrown, the Portuguese dictatorship was overthrown, the Spanish dictatorship was overthrown. We had revolutions in Asia with Vietnam, in Cuba, and so on. All these took place in the period of a decline in profitability for capitalism and a relatively strong international working class. Then we had a period when, with neoliberalism, where the working class in the global north was decimated by the switch of industry to the rest of the world. And those countries still had to develop a working class of any sort of force. And then we've entered a period of depression with very low growth and not really much going for workers, and unions have been decimated. All I can say is it seems to me just in the last few years, we're beginning to see a change in that. We're beginning to see a turnaround in working class organizations and their ability to struggle. I'll finish on this point. Revolutions don't happen very often. You may have noticed, but it's a very difficult thing to go through a revolutionary process to change society completely. And to have an agency to change that, the working class, it's difficult for that to happen, but it does happen. And when it happens, it transforms things dramatically. So you could go for a whole human lifetime without any revolution, and then you get one and it dramatically changes the lifetimes of the next two generations.
Okay, I'm gonna ask people to please try and keep questions down to 2 minutes. We're running near the end of our time, allotted time period. Next is Jean, followed by Kit, followed by David, followed by Norma. So go ahead, Jean.
Okay, well, thanks so much. I can't claim to have followed all the discussion, all the economics of it clearly, but I certainly agree, and as a Marxist, that the problem is capitalism and the solution is socialism. But also as an anthropologist, I know that capitalism is not a universal feature of human social life. If you go back 1,000 years, then capitalism was not the dominant system. There were these large agrarian empires that were organized according to strikingly different principles. That they had their own problems, to be sure, but capitalism and the current kind of capitalist crises were not part of them. So the solution, again, is to, I think, get rid of capitalism, as a number of people have said. And also we look to the working class. And I would just remind you that, first of all, I'm a Bernie person. I support Bernie that takes a somewhat different tack on a lot of these things. But I also, my favorite Marxist is Xi Jinping, as I've said quite a bit of times. And, we have to remember that the largest sector of the international working class is Chinese, and it's also the best organized. So I just want to throw some of those thoughts out, and particularly in terms of the role of China, because some people see China as a stabilizing factor in the globalizing economy. But I'll let you respond, or your thoughts on China and other aspects here. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Eugene. Well, let me just say, you're absolutely right. Capitalism actually has not been around in human society since the beginning, although capitalist economists would tell you that it's been here eternally, that the market has been here forever, and supply and demand is the way things of human beings have always operated. This is absolute nonsense historically and anthropologically. It's just ridiculous. We know from the very beginnings of human organization that capitalism was not existing in any form whatsoever. What do we mean by capitalism? We mean the private ownership of the means of production by a small group of people who exploit and use the rest of us as wage laborers who own no means of production and property. The division between the owners of the means of production and those who sell their labor only in order to produce things for profit. That system has not existed except for the last 250 years or so. And it's only become dominant in that period. The small bits of capitalist mode of production that existed before that were small sectors of the economy. The vast feudal system, which lasted for 1,000 years in Europe and other countries, the Asian absolutist system lasted even longer. Slave economies have lasted for thousands of years before that. Capitalism is a relatively new and young system, one that has dramatically taken productive forces forward more than any other system before it, but also have dramatically increased the contradictions between rich and poor, owners and non-owners, and between, and it has now reached the point in the 21st century where it's actually destroying the planet, let alone the rest of us. And that's why we need to move on to a better organization of human society. And we have the agency to do that. As you say, working class people around the world, the working class has never been larger in the world, never. It's a huge force. It didn't exist even 100 years ago to the size that it does now, and as a proportion of the total population. Peasants have disappeared. Small businessmen and so-called middle-class people like that are a minority. Capitalist elite is a tiny, tiny minority. The vast majority of people have to go to work for a living, and they're working people. That's, they don't necessarily agree that they should organize together, but that's what they are objectively. And as you say, the vast majority of those working people now exist not in the global north and the advanced capitalist economies. They exist in the global south, of the 3 or 4 billion people, adults, who are working class now. 70% of those are out into the so-called global south in countries like China and India. And there's the forces for future change in the world. China, I haven't got time to go into the nature of China. You go on my blog, you can see my point of view, which isn't necessarily the same as many other Marxists. I see China in revolution as transforming China from being under the halo of imperialism towards the development of new society. It's not getting there, but that's another matter. But we can say this one point is that the Chinese working class is the most important agency of change in the future for in the 21st century towards a better society, a socialist society.
Okay, Kit, followed by David, followed by Norma. So Kit, 2 minutes, please.
Yes, thank you for your presentation and slides, Michael. Many or most of us are not economists like you are, but we do recognize the problem of profits over people and also the need for workers of the world to unite. You've answered my questions, especially after Raj. It had to do with the labor movement. But can you do more comparison between the UK and EU labor movement and the US, because we have a particular dynamic here in this country. And then also, can you talk about the state of fascism in the world? Because that, I think, is also a growing problem. Thank you.
Big questions, Kit. All right, let me deal with the fascism one. Well, as we've seen, the failure of leaders of the labor movements in Europe and elsewhere, what in Europe is called social democracy, where the aim of the leaders of the labor movement there is a gradual improvement of the conditions of working people within the capitalist system. That has failed because capitalism has got into difficulties, and it's not possible to make the sort of reforms that we saw in that golden age between 1950 and 1970, where we saw the development of various gains in public services in the welfare state. What has happened since? Most of those things have been gradually taken away, and social democracy has gone along with this. As a result, working class support for social democratic parties in Europe and the UK has gradually declined, and it's increasingly declined. What has replaced it? Not a more revolutionary socialist wing of the working class on the whole, but instead the development of parties which claim that socialism is the problem, or that working organizations of the working class are the problem, and what we need is a more radical authoritarian regime. Various populist parties, they're called, which are gaining electoral strength across various European countries. And of course, you've had your own form of populism under the Trump administration, and that hasn't still gone away yet. Probably come back to haunt you in a few years' time. So this is the result of the increasing problems that capitalism faces and the failure of social democracy to be able to deal with that. And that's the danger that we have before us in the development of these right-wing organizations. At the moment, I'm glad to say that they don't have real control over state power yet. That could lead to disaster. And to add just an optimistic note, that doesn't apply in the global south. Yes, there are fascist movements there, but we also have a big swing amongst the working class, particularly in South America, towards left-wing parties that have gained political and governmental control and are aimed to defend working people against this development of fascism. And they have to move on too to deal with their own capitalist companies. Otherwise, they will face the same problem in the future.
Okay, David, if you would go ahead and ask your question, followed by Norma. David?
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Roberts. Excellent presentation. My question is one about the nature of capitalism and an observation with a question. It seems like all capitalism gets conflated with global capitalism. And I'm wondering if there's a useful or an interesting distinction that could be made by a different type of capitalism. I'm thinking of the mom and pop shop. I'm thinking of a pair of partners who save money and maybe take out a small loan. They grow a small business. They hire staff and continue to expand the business at a local level. So there's entrepreneurship and innovation and some of these things that we would typically embrace as an American culture. And then that story could, you know, go forward or unfold from there. Is that a useful distinction, or is there a name for that type of capitalism, or does it all ultimately relate to global capitalism that we, you know, have identified its severe and significant limitations?
Yeah, well, Dave, I think the important thing here is what we want to deal with, our real enemy, if you like, as working people, is big global capital, big business, the multinational companies. They control the vast majority of resources. They employ most of the labor. They make the most profits. They control their politicians. These are the people, or these are the entities, the organizations that we need to replace with a democratic, planned, publicly owned system. So small businesses that you've described are not our main enemy, because they don't really have the power, just like workers don't, to change much at all, except to provide their own living and employ maybe a small number of people. Lots of workers are employed by small businesses, huge numbers of workers, but they are not, these small businesses and their workers in them are not decisive for the economy. In my view, if we have control of, pardon me, what we used to call the commanding heights of the economy, these big multinationals, then we could provide the resources and support for small businesses for them to find decent credit, decent facilities in order to maintain their businesses. And eventually you could offer the encouragement of them coming into cooperatives together, into cooperative small organizations, big communities, so that we move away from small businesses competing against each other and cutting their wages and their conditions to do so into a cooperative system, which is supported by the public services and the banks and other institutions. We need to move towards a cooperative society based on a planned economy. And then small businesses would probably gradually disappear. They would become part of the local community, which would operate on a democratic basis, linking regionally and nationally. But the main enemy is the big boys first. Then we can help the small boys or girls.
Thank you.
Okay, Norma, if you would go ahead, unmute, please. There you go.
Yes, hi, everybody. And
thank you,
Michael. That's cute, Nina. I'm looking at Ann Lewis's posting on the chat. She's mulling over, she thinks a large part of alienation in the private and public sector is lack of organization. We see this represented in part by declining unionization in both areas. This bears on what has put me in touch with this kind of behavior of working, of connecting, of trying to create our revolution. And that is that we want to work to make ourselves able to have lovely lives where work becomes our joy instead of our burden. Mm-hmm. And it's been said here, I think I've had a lot of difficulty understanding it. It's always sounded as though you're talking and then a lower voice comes in and then you're talking in a lower, it gets interrupted. So I haven't been able to get accept a few snatches, and you and
sorry, other,
yeah, I know. You and other people, I think, have said some things that connect to what I'm talking about, and I think that's an emphasis. If we were organizing, if organizers were organizing, and can you begin to imagine a lovely life for you and the community and the world? Can we talk about that and define those as being the goals? I think that alienation would begin to be ameliorated and maybe even begin to approach those people in the white supremacist hills if they could have their say and everybody being agreeable. And it'd be going along with a lot of what you were just saying about combining work efforts and so on. Changing what work is. I run for Berkeley School Board, and I do it in order. I tell people I'm communist, and I do it in order to see if people will begin to think about stopping age segregation. Age segregation is foundational to our behavior. We wake up our baby to go and be part of childcare during the day. Our baby, our 60-month-old baby, our 7-year-olds, we take them out of their warm sleep and put them in the organization, which is like us being forced to march to our cubicle for the day, 5 days a week. We have to think about working to end the idea of an 8-hour day, you know, that is not God-given and all that, that has been referenced, as I say, in some of what's been said here. There was a...
That's about 3.5 minutes, Norma. Let me go ahead and...
One half a line, okay?
Okay, go ahead. Please hurry.
It was 1,000 years ago was referenced, and with the dawn of everything, if people have read it, societies went in and out of formations, but eventually even a good society seems mostly to have risen to a hierarchical arrangement where most of the people made a few people able to live without really working alongside of them. So the awareness, let us work for what we want, you know, the new phrase.
Michael, if you could, we've kept you on a very long time. If you could combine your answer maybe with some closing remarks.
Yeah, that would be great. Well, I think Norma provides us with, in some ways, some closing remarks. She's saying, look, we need a world where people are not toiling for a living, but we live instead for work, for activity, for human activity, for creative activity. That world is what we're aiming for, a world where toil is ended, where exploitation is ended, where a small group of people who have everything and control the rest of us is ended. The inequalities that existed in previous societies, including capitalism, which has in many ways created even worse. We need to end that. And it's possible. Humanity can come together on the basis of the objective conditions of using all the resources of the world in common ownership and in a common plan to bring us together to cooperate. And the agency for that is that the vast majority of the world has nothing else to lose but their chains, to use the Marxist phrase. They own pretty much nothing except their labor power. And that brings them together in a united basis for a better society. So meet to come together, to cooperate, to produce and use the resources of the world, both to meet human needs and to avoid the degradation of the planet, to unite that together. That must be our objective. And we may be going through yet another crisis under capitalism, but I still feel that the resources and the agency exist in the world for us to change that.
Thank you very much, Michael. Tremendous presentation. I want to thank everybody who participated. We had everybody stick through practically from the beginning to the end, and really appreciate it. Apologies to several of you who had questions in the second round that we weren't able to get to. I would highly recommend checking out Michael's blog at thenextrecession.wordpress.com. Sign up for his notifications for when he posts. It's better than CNBC and Bloomberg Business in terms of what's going on in the world today. We're going to stop the recording and then go over to a few more minutes of informal interaction.
Institute for the Critical Study of Society at the Niebuhr-Proctor Marxist Library receives no corporate funding, nor do we have any paid staff. We rely on the support of working class folks that share our commitment to the socialist legacy of Karl Marx. We continue to need funds to meet necessary expenses, since we can no longer pass the hat at our in-person forums. Please send contributions to our treasurer, either online via PayPal or by check. The PayPal ID is ICSS Sunday, S-U-N-D-A-Y, at yahoo.com. And the name is Richard Fallenbaum. And checks may be made out to Richard Fallenbaum and sent to him at 1225 Nielsen Street, Berkeley, California, 94706. Fallenbaum is spelled F-A-L-L-E-N-B-A-U-M. To donate directly to the Marxist Library, send a check to the Niebuhr-Proctor Marxist Library at 6501 Telegraph Avenue, Oakland, California, 94609. Or directly, or donate online at www.paypal.me/npml. Info for information, write to npml at marxistlibr.org. and the website is marxistlibr.org.